more people on top of it. It's been a very busy place this summer, which is great. But and one year we'll do this there. I have here a sign-up sheet. I'm going to circulate because there is still a question about contact tracing, perhaps, if something unfortunate should happen. I know you're all vaccinated and masked, but we just want to make sure we know who is here in this space together. And because we didn't sell tickets, we don't know who you are. So please let us know. I'm not going to talk too much because John has a lot to say. But I do want to remind you about the box picnic, the Baroque picnic tonight at the Atlantic Boat Company at 5:30. That's when the music will start. We thought when we were going to be selling food that we would start doing that at 5 o'clock. However, we will not have food for purchase, and I hope you all know that and are planning to bring your own picnic. There's plenty of space. We'll have big tables, so there will be plenty of space for social distancing if you're concerned about that. It's going to be a really wonderful program, and we will have beverages for purchase. Bring your own food, but please not your own alcoholic beverages. That takes a special license, which we do not have. So, and we have, pardon me?
What is on the program?
What is on the program? I don't have a program. Two Vivaldi concerti, one for bassoon and one for violin. There's a bit of Handel with featuring trumpet, Mr. Handel's water suite, water music.
There's a concerto for movement for three violins.
Right. And some Telemann.
Yep.
And a special appearance singing the Glories of Coffee by our wonderful soprano, Nola. And if you have a chance, if you do Facebook, look at Nola's posting on Facebook. Is that Facebook?
Are you talking about the
film? The film of Heidi
Schmidt. Okay.
It'll get you ready if you have a chance this afternoon or even afterwards. She does a very, very funny thing with Heidi Schmidt. There are I said I wasn't going to talk a lot, and now I'm blabbing on. There are no tickets available for Saturday night, so I hope you all have yours. If you don't, you can email info@bluehillmont.org to be put on a wait list. Wouldn't be really optimistic, but the space is really tight at the Congregational Church. Thank you all for coming and for supporting Blue Hill Mont, and please enjoy what John has to say to us. And
thank you,
wonderful musicians. He'll introduce
you. Thank you. Yeah, I'm very blessed to have so many colleagues with me today. I realize that some of you will not be able to hear the concert on Saturday, so today's talk is going to include a bit more of the actual music from the concert than I sometimes do. So that's why I'm a little bit, I have so much to say about the music, but I want you to hear lots of the music. We're calling this concert Songs of Praise and Jubilation. And one of the pieces you're going to hear parts of today is a cantata number 51, which is Jauchzet Gott in allen Landen, praise God in all countries. It's one of the few cantatas that Bach wrote for one single voice, soprano in this case, and we have Nola Richardson as our soprano soloist, and she's going to sing a few excerpts from that for us to begin. I'm very blessed to have my great colleague, Sarah Freiberg, on cello here today. Sarah and I were just talking about the fact that Baroque music is really led from the bass. It was one of the first and most important lessons I learned when I went to college, was as opposed to when I learned to play the piano, always the right hand is what you wanted to work on, the top notes. But when I got to college and I concentrated on Baroque music, one of the first things my teacher said was, you have to lead from the bass. It's the bass, the bass line creates the foundation for all of this intricate work above the bass line. So I'm extremely glad. You would hear the bass line if I played it on the piano, but you, or on the harpsichord, but you'll hear it so much more clearly with Sarah playing it with me. So Nola, I thought we'd maybe give them the beginning of Jauchzet Gott in allen Landen. This is sheer jubilation. It's extremely virtuosic writing for the soprano. You have to imagine a trumpet playing with strings, but I think you can imagine that with just hearing the sound of Nola's voice and this great bass line. This is, I think, I haven't done all the research, but I think this piece includes the highest note that Bach ever wrote for soprano, which is a high C. I don't think he ever wrote anything higher than high C, so enjoy. Here's the beginning. Intricate filigree played by two violins around that. And then all at once it breaks into an Alleluia. Maybe you just sing the beginning of the Alleluia?
Sure.
So after the chorale, sorry, this is a little bit off book, but it's such an exciting moment. So the chorale ends, and you think that might be the end of the whole piece, because it would be a very logical place to stop. But no, Bach has so much more in store for us. So we'll start right on the Alleluia.
Okay.
Imagine you just heard a chorale sung in slow notes, and suddenly here's the Alleluia. And then this exquisite aria where the words are O Most High, Höchste is the word in German, O Most High, referring to God, let your goodness be renewed every morning. And you'll hear the word Höchste, which means highest one, in the very highest register. Not quite the high C, but quite often the high A. And there's a beautiful bass line which needs a beautiful cellist, which we happen to have. So.
Thank you.
coffee cantata aria this afternoon at this afternoon's concert. So if I go a little bit beyond 1 o'clock, she and Sarah might need to head out because they need to rehearse that at 1:45 over at the boat company. Do you want to help that? Oh, that's our bass player. So I want to talk about the other cantata that we're going to be doing on the program. There are three works on the program on Saturday night. Motet for eight voices, splendid motet. This glorious cantata, and then cantata number 147, Herz und Mund und Tat und Leben. And this is a cantata that was written for the Feast of the Visitation. And I'm going to talk at length about a little bit about that feast. So it's important to remember, I think the music makes a lot more sense if you hear it in the context of a Lutheran worship service, where people would have heard the a particular reading, they would have a particular biblical story in mind, the preacher would have preached on the subject, the themes that were brought up in that story, and the music enhances and comments on everything that's part of the liturgy for that service. So if I will speak in the terms of the Christian and Lutheran language. I know we're not all of the same religious backgrounds, but I think it helps hear the music even more vividly if we know why Bach wrote a particular harmony here or a particular figure here. So the Feast of the Visitation recounts the story. I have to give a little bit of background. So and I think these stories are probably not new to any of you, but the story of the Annunciation, when Mary is visited by the angel who suddenly appears to her and says, "Hail Mary, full of grace, you are blessed among women. You will bear the Lord. You will give birth to the Lord." And she says, "But how can this be? I'm a virgin. I have known no man." And the angel says, "The Holy Ghost will come upon you, and you will conceive in your womb. You will have a son. You will call his name Jesus, and he will be the Savior of humankind." So that happens, and as a little bit of a side note, the angel says, "Oh, and by the way, you know your cousin Elizabeth? She's pretty old. She's probably in her 70s. They've been wanting to have a kid for all these years. She's pregnant, too. And she, in fact, she's already 6 months pregnant. And so that's already a miracle that somebody in that age, someone who was already denoted as barren, has conceived a child." So Mary says, "Be it with me according to your word." The angel departs. Very soon after that, Mary makes a trip into the hill country to visit her cousin Elizabeth. And this is the Visitation. So this is the story that is recounted on the Feast of the Visitation. Mary visits Elizabeth, and Elizabeth says the first words to her are, "How you are blessed among women. How is it that the mother of my Lord comes to visit me? And because the minute you greeted me, the minute I heard you say, 'Hi, Elizabeth, it's me, it's Mary,' the baby in my womb leapt for joy." And so you can just imagine, I've never been pregnant, but I've heard that sometimes the baby does kick. And so that's the kind of movement that happened. Mary is pregnant, or Elizabeth is pregnant with John the Baptist. Her son will be born and becomes John the Baptist. And so the mystery of this whole story is said to be that John the Baptist, already in his mother's womb, already recognizes the presence of the Lord coming as Mary's unborn child. And Elizabeth also recognizes that Mary is bearing the Lord Jesus. And the whole theme of this, the service for that day of the Feast of the Visitation is how we all need to recognize Jesus as our Savior, as our salvation. And to the word that's used quite often in this cantata is the German word bekennen, which can mean a couple of different things. we acknowledge our Savior. We acknowledge Jesus as our Savior. We recognize Jesus as our Savior. We accept him as our Savior. And the opening chorus is very festive, talking about Herz und Mund und Tat und Leben. Heart, we have to accept Jesus with our heart. Herz, Mund, with our mouth, with our voice. Tat, with our actions. And Leben, with our entire lives. We need to acknowledge Jesus. Second movement is one of three recitatives. The recitatives in this cantata are very special because Bach composed them especially for this cantata to comment on the story of the Visitation. So one of my other great colleagues is Zach Fisher, tenor, and he's going to now sing his recitative in this cantata. So I like to think of this recitative as taking place in three different segments. And the first segment, kind of like to imagine that there's a big screen up here, and we've been watching the story. So you will have already heard them read the story of Mary going to visit Elizabeth, and Elizabeth responding in great joy and saying, "Blessed are you among women. The baby kicked in my womb because he was so excited that the mother of my Lord is arriving." So imagine that scene up here, and Zach is going to comment on that. So Mary's response after Elizabeth says, "The baby recognized that my Lord is with you," Mary responds with the hymn of praise that we know as the Magnificat. Many of you will know that that text. "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has regarded the lowliness of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations will call me blessed." I won't go on with the entire hymn of praise, but I'm going to quote a little bit more from it later. So imagine that you're watching the scene of Mary saying, "My soul magnifies the Lord, for behold, from henceforth all generations will call me, this lowly handmaiden will call me blessed." And Zach begins by commenting on that. So imagine you're watching that scene and Zach sings this, and I'll translate it in a minute. This is accompanied by a full string orchestra sustaining beautiful chords. So we have at least Sarah to sustain. I'll harpsichord doesn't sustain, but I'll voice of Mary, or blessed words of Mary. And so he says, "Oh, gebenedeiter Mund," Mary makes her inmost soul open. And so notice that when Mary begins the Magnificat, she doesn't say, "Hey, praise the Lord." She says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." Her inmost being magnifies the Lord. So he says, her inmost soul proclaims the greatness of God. She begins by just talking about herself. "He has done great works to me, his lowly maid." Das Er, was Er, the high note that he sang, is the word for God, that what God has done to me, his lowly servant. And so it ends with a very low note. Then he sort of turns away from the screen and says, "Okay now, guys, you, human race, you're the sons of, the slaves of Satan, you're the slaves of sin, and you have been redeemed by the Savior." So here's a change of character, And we'll just go up. No, don't say that. Yeah. So we had this little comment on Mary's reference to Mary's beautiful words, and now he's addressing the congregation. When Bach gets to really interesting words, he says, "You human race, you've been freed from all of this burden and all of this nastiness." He gets to this chord, very unstable, diminished seventh chord. And so you can also hear a little change of character in the way Zach is singing. It's a little more admonishment to the, as opposed to reflecting on the beautiful scene that we just saw. Then it gets even more of an admonishment, and he's going to say, "So human race, you have been saved by the salvation of Jesus," is what he just said. But your voice, dein verstockt Gemüte, as opposed to Mary's voice, your voice denies this mercy. And verstockt is an important word. We're going to come back to that in a minute, because when we get to John's recipe, it comes back. Verstockt can mean your stubbornness, your obstinacy, your obduracy. Your stubborn nature denies God's goodness. And then it gets even, he says, doch wisse, and wisse means no. It's K-N-O-W. It's the imperative of the verb to know. Or it could be translated as, hey, remember. And what he says is, doch wisse, dass dich nach der Schrift ein allzu scharfes Urteil trifft. Remember that according to the scriptures, there's a very, very harsh judgment waiting for you at the end of time. So after this lovely, soft, beautiful scene of remembering Mary, praising the Lord, he's admonishing us, okay, pay attention, and remember there's a bad, there's a possibly harsh judgment waiting for you at the end of time. So this is now, after he's told you that you've been saved, he's going to talk about how your voice denies. And listen to the angst that comes in this, and the high register that Bach uses to great effect. So you play the down beginning of 13.
Yet
it's commenting on the reading that we've heard. It's telling you about your own life and what you need to do. So, Zach, thank you. Beautifully, beautifully sung. This is followed by an alto aria, and I just want to say a quick word about German. The German language, it has a slightly different structure than English. So the first words that the alto sings right after Zach has just admonished us that there's a harsh judgment awaiting, the first words she says is, are schäme dich, which means shame on you. But in German, actually, that's not the end of the sentence. It's schäme dich, o seele nicht, which is don't be ashamed. But I have to think that Bach's congregation would have heard schäme dich. It's what you say to a little kid when they've done something bad. Oh, schäme dich. It's like, shame on you. But in fact, it's don't be ashamed, o soul. Don't be ashamed to recognize God as your Savior. When God calls you, when you're in the presence of God, of Jesus, and he acknowledges you as one of his own, don't be ashamed to take him as your Savior. So it's just an interesting grammatical thing that schäme dich oder sehe nicht is the end of that sentence. After that aria comes another recitative, and this is sung by my great colleague John Adams. And this first word that he says, now we've got the screen back up here of Mary proclaiming the Magnificat, and one of the phrases that she says is, he has put down the mighty from their seats. And in fact, sometimes the verb is not just to put them down, but to actually shove them off of their seats, or to shove the mighty off of their throne. God has put down the mighty from their seat and has raised up the humble and meek. So, and the words that he says at the beginning, he uses the word verstockung, which I disagree with the way it's translated in the program. I think it's translated as astonishment. It doesn't really mean that in this case. I think it should be translated as stubbornness or pigheadedness or arrogance, because it's the whole sentence is verstockung kann gewaltige verblenden. The gewaltige are the mighty ones or the powerful, and it's basically saying the powerful ones can be blinded by their own stubbornness. So in German it's backwards. Stubbornness can blind the mighty ones. So just sing that opening chord.
Okay.
And again, it starts with this unstable diminished seventh chord.
Verstockung kann gewaltige verblenden.
Phrase he says is stubbornness can blind the mighty until the hand of the Almighty pushes them off of their seats. And listen to how Sarah demonstrates, it gives a very clear representation of somebody falling off of a seat by playing a descending arpeggio that goes two octaves and lands right down the bottom of the range. So we'll do the very beginning of it so we can get the connection.
Verstockung kann gewaltige verblenden, bis sie des Höchsten Arm vom Stuhle stößt. Doch diese Arme
So, this is the contrast. So, the pushing him off the seat, we're going to do that one again because I love that. this same arm lifts up those of low degree. Now, again, it's a funny little thing in German. The Germans have, the words have a little bit more power, a little more sustaining power. So a German can say something here and not really finish the thought until here, and in the middle put in a whole different thought. So this is in German, doch dieser Arm erhebt, obschon vor ihm der Ehrenkreis erbebt, hingegen die Elenden, die erlöst. Which means, we would say, yet this arm, the same arm that pushed the mighty off of their seat, this same arm lifts up those of low degree, even though that arm is so powerful that the earth might quake before it. But in German they do it this way. But this arm, although the earth might quake before it, lifts up those of low degree. And the quaking part is demonstrated by repeated notes, as opposed to actually just play sustained notes where he has the repeated notes. So
okay.
Just play them. So instead of having sustained notes, he gives the cello repeated notes, which is the sense of. Go ahead. Shaking, trembling. So maybe let's do from the beginning up there through that part. So.
Verstockung kann gewaltige verblenden, bis sie des höchsten Arm vom Stuhle stößt. Doch diese Arme in the
mighty off of their seats, raised up the lowly of those of low degree. And he turns to the congregation again now, now in a very different character from Zach's recit. And he says, this is a great time for you. This is the time of salvation. Get up, be happy, be joyous, because this is the time when you will be healed. And so Bach now changes from a recitative to more of an arioso style, where instead of just individual notes or effects, Sarah has a beautiful melody to play, and John has a beautiful, equally beautiful melody. I love that. So maybe we do
Hoch mit Blick der Christen auf, machet euch bereit, es ist die Tage der Zeit.
It's more encouraging. So when it goes back to just individual chords in the bass, he's saying the Savior is bidding you to arm yourself with the gifts of faith. So call out to him, cry to him. Rufen is the verb, which means to cry or to call out. Call to him with fervent longing so that you can receive him as your Savior. So maybe just do from the Highland. Mm-hmm. Nice story to play. So this is the recitative section starting at 15.
Der Heiland heißt euch Leib und Geist mit Glaubensgaben rüstet. Auf Ruhe zu ihm im künftigen Verlangen um ihm im Glauben zu empfangen.
And in some ways, they're so much more, they're equally rich and so powerful in their, in everything that Bach does with them, especially in Bach. So the aria that follows this, remember John has exhorted us to cry out, to call to Jesus, that he can come and that we can accept him as our Savior. And the soprano aria right after that is the soul calling out. And when you call for somebody, I think you don't usually call in a low voice. You call in a high voice, hey, 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 over there. So translate that into very elegant and refined music, and that becomes a very high, beautiful, silvery soprano voice, as opposed to, I think it's why John, he didn't write this for alto. He wrote this for soprano in a very high key, in a very high tessitura. So Jennifer, oh my God, your name just went out of my head.
Bates.
My dear colleague who sang Bist du bei mir so beautifully last night. Is the soprano soloist for this aria. And there are three components to this aria. I want to introduce them one at a time. First, a sort of a walking bass. So often when Bach is writing music that talks about preparing a way or preparing a pathway, there's a walking bass line. So Sarah and I will play that for you.
Thank you.
phrase. I'm going to have Jennifer sing it alone first, just the phrase. So. So the third element is the violin solo, which we don't have a violinist today, but I'm going to play part of the violin part myself. It's almost entirely triplets, and I wanted to say a little bit about this. Sarah and I were talking about this, and this may not be such an enormous deal, but I think it kind of is. There are four movements in this cantata where triplets go throughout the entire movement. I mean, unstoppable triplets. And a triplet is so easy to recognize because it has three parts, a beginning, a middle, and an end. So, and he writes it, the violin part, for example, has figures like this, where it's very easy to hear 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Bach loved symbolism and he loved numerology. And I think the fact that he uses so many triplets throughout this piece is not lost to be trifled with. You'll hear in this movement and in two others that I'll demonstrate today, uninterrupted triplets for long stretches of time. Occasionally they stop just to cadence. But listen to this, we'll play it all together. We'll do the whole thing. We'll do from the very beginning. Theology of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Is it just a magical number of threes, or is it just beautiful music? It could be all of those and more. So Bach wrote this cantata in 10 movements, 6 of them to be done early in the service, and that's the 6th one. Then there's a break. The sermon would happen, and then during communion, at the end of the service, he wrote 4 more movements to be done. And the first movement you hear as the beginning of the second part is another movement that has triplets throughout the entire movement. And they're played, this interestingly, in Bach's manuscript, it's not entirely clear who's supposed to play these. He wrote it on the bass line, so we assume that it could be one of three people, or all of three people, the cello player, the bass player, the continuo player, the keyboard player. The continuo player could be playing the harpsichord or the organ. So, and if you Google around, if you have time and would like to look at different versions of this aria, you'll hear recordings where the triplets are played by the cellist, you'll hear recordings where they're played by the entire cello and bass section in more modern performances. You'll hear recordings where they're played just by the harpsichord or just by the organ. Those, I think, are the least effective because the harpsichord and the organ don't carry very well in this particular range. Whereas, so we're going to do it with cello. This aria, it's a tenor aria, and it will be sung by Dan Pokewell, who we haven't met yet. He's arriving today. We're going to rehearse with this tomorrow. So I wanted to just say a few words about how we decide on an interpretation, the tempo, the articulation, the character. The words that are of this aria are, help Jesus, help me to be able to receive you. Now, you could interpret that as a desperate cry for help, of urgency, oh, help, 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 Jesus. Or more excited, I can do this, but I just need some help. And it really affects the tempo that we choose and the articulation that we choose. There are no indications of articulation, which means that the triplets could be played with all three notes under one bow. If you want to just play a bit. Or they could be played, there's no indication that they need to be slurred, they could be all separate bows with one bow per note. So. And even with that, then we have the variety of choices to make as far as tempo. Play it once really slowly and with somebody was supposed to play triplets, I think it should be the cellist, and somebody else, he indicates it just by adding a stem, a different stem, to the first note of each triplet. So I think that's what the harpsichord or organ and bass would play. Let's play it together from the beginning, including the first one. With Dan tomorrow when we rehearse this piece before Saturday night's performance. Yes, we do always sometimes just put these things together the day before concerts. It's remarkable. I just love being part of this festival because we can do that. But we're going to talk about the character and imagine that Sarah and I listened to a recording that we decided we didn't like where it was so anxious and so urgent because every single note was just played. You don't play a little bit like that? And it was at that tempo, and it just, I said, okay, is this supposed to be desperate? Is it anxious? Is it despairing? And I think not. I think we're going to aim for something more like that. Now, Zach has agreed to sing just the very beginning of this, so you can hear the words, Hilf Jesu Hilf, help Jesus help. And he'll just sing a little bit of it, and we'll play both.
Thank you.
much. So I would say the last two pieces I can do myself. If you need to take off, I'm going to finish pretty much at 1 o'clock. So the next aria, the next recitative is sung by our alto, Marcia Sly, who does many other things this week, as you know. And this is another recitative where we get the movie going again, and now we're recalling the actual action where Mary shows up, Elizabeth greets her and says, oh, the baby just kicked in my womb. And in fact, you hear, when you'll hear her sing the words, she talks about Johannes, Johannes meaning John the Baptist, the baby that's that Elizabeth will give birth to. And when she says, Johannes muss mit Geist erfüllt werden, the tenses in German are also a little bit more sort of here and now and present and future and past all mixed together. So it's written in the present tense. Sometimes it's translated in the past tense. So literally, John, or Johannes, must be filled with the Holy Spirit, or he must have been filled with the Holy Spirit, because that he recognizes the approach of the Savior, even though he's unborn and in his mother's womb. He wird bewegt, erhüpft und springt. So you'll hear these words, wird bewegt, erhüpft und springt. And the accompaniment to this recitative is two oboes da caccia, the oboe that's longer and curved, sometimes replaced in modern performances by the English horn, a very low, deep-sounding oboe. And at that point, they've been playing beautiful, smooth lines. Always together, both English horn, or both oboes da caccia together. But when it gets to the part about kicking in the womb, they play separate notes. Hear it in the bass lines too. So there's just a little bit of elbowing there. So this one again falls into two segments. The first segment, again, we've got this scene of Mary visiting Elizabeth. And we'll, let's go do the first half. And says, you know what, if your heart is burning for Jesus and you just can't find the words, God will be the one that gives you the strength to call on Jesus as your Savior. He will give you the words. And so listen to the beautiful conciliatory section at the end. So what we just ended, why don't we play the downbeat of 25?
Wir sind in euch.
trumpet, strings, and bass soloist. Ian Pomerantz is going to be singing that aria, and it's a very solid, very much like the aria that opened Yauks at Gotten out of London. These cantatas have nothing to do with each other, but it's very much the same character. So very much in the same happy character, very straightforward. And then at the very end of the cantata, Bach does something I don't think he's done this in any other cantata, where he brings back an entire movement that he used. So the same movement that he used at the beginning, at the end of the first half. And you know what? I think we have time to do the whole thing. Why don't we just sing through it? Because everybody loves this piece. So he ends again with this flowing triplet movement through Jesus leidet meine Freude, which is Jesus is my joy, I will never let him out of my heart. And my whole team of colleagues and I will present this.
Thank you so much. Enjoy the day.